Hi, this is Smiley from Gene Loves Jezebel. And you're listening to the New Wave Music Podcast.
Welcome back to the New Wave Music Podcast. As always, this is Steve. A T-Bone is still on assignment, but I am joined by a special guest today. You're no doubt going to remember our guest we have today from the band Reflex, which many of you will remember the hit Politics of Dancing. The politics of dancing, the politics of ooh, feeling good, the politics of moving, oh, is this message understood? The politics of dancing. I'm joined by Mr. Paul Fishman. Paul, thank you very much for joining us. It's an honor to have you on the show.
Nice to be here.
At what age did you decide you're going to be a musician?
I sort of grew up with music all around me from when I was a child. My father was a very well-known and established songwriter. He used to write songs for people like Tom Jones, wrote things like, do you remember Tom Jones's hit, Help Yourself?
Just help yourself to my lips, to my arms, just say the word and they are yours. Just help yourself to the love in my heart, your smile has opened up the door.
That was a number one hit in America. So he wrote loads and loads of songs for people. And because of that, I was surrounded by people who were kind of, music was normal. You know, people would come to our house and they would play the piano and start singing. So it was kind of, it was there all the time. And then my father loved listening to records. He turned them up really loud, which was great, really. But it kind of, what happened with me was I'd been interested in music, but I didn't really like having piano lessons and stuff like that. And then at some point I decided I wanted to learn the flute, and I started flute lessons, and that kind of led to me getting into music college. And so I'd kind of already, I tell this story to some people, I used to do engineering when I was at school, and the guy who was quite a brutal teacher, he would say to the guy, all the guys in it, he said, what do you want to do when you leave school? And I said to him, well, I think I'd quite like to be a record producer. This was like when I was about 15 or 16. He said to me, well, that's very good. That's very good. He said, you're going to need to know about thermoplastics, molding and things like that. I said, no, I don't think you do. I think all you need to do is about how to listen and how to understand the way that music's put together. So that kind of really led to me, because I went to music college, and then it was kind of my career started really professionally when I've been performing a bit with some experimental music groups in London, and then I did some music for a project which got me an album deal with Warner Brothers, which was like when I was about 19. So that was when I first released an album called In Search of Ancient Gods under the name of Absolute Elsewhere. Does that vaguely answer your question?
That does. With your dad being a songwriter, what were some of your influences, or what shaped your music career?
Obviously, the records that you hear when you're very young. I remember when I was about, I must have been maybe 6 or 7 or something like that. And I went to the, no, actually maybe 8 years old. I went to the local fair and I heard the Beatles. I heard Please Please Me and From Me to You on really loud speakers at the fair, and I thought this just sounded amazing, like nothing else I'd ever heard. And that kind of had a deep effect upon me. You know, the first record I bought was actually Please Please Me. I bought that along with the Hollies, Just One Look. I've still got them. But that had a deep effect, but also the music that I heard, some of the music that my father played, I was really interested in. Yeah, Ray Charles. And Bobby Darin as well, and people like that. And because he liked to turn it up loud, it wasn't like other people where they were going, oh, yeah, I've got a nice piece of music. He could turn it up, and he really enjoyed the thrill of it. He wasn't a musician, which is where we are different in many levels, but he wasn't a musician. He just wrote songs and lyrics and worked with billions of people.
So how did the band The Reflex come to be as a band?
When I left the music college, I already had an album out, and I've been doing quite a lot of session work. I've been making records with other people. I released quite a few other different sort of records, just experimenting and learning about how to use the recording studio. And at some point, I decided that I wanted to kind of form a band that was sort of different to what was around, and with really kind of select the right elements for it, the right type of people, because every group is the sum of the parts, and it's the mixture of the chemistry, and everybody should bring something kind of special to the table. So what happened was I met some guy who's now a very well-known producer called Nick Launay, and he was very young, and he introduced me to John Baxter, and then also introduced me to Francois Craig. It was a kind of a group of people. Do you remember a record called Pop Music?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Well, all the people that I initially worked with were related to that. They were the people who made those kind of records, including Nick. That was never really a live band, and I was interested in kind of creating something that was exciting and a really good live band that was very well rehearsed, really tight, understood each other as musicians. And that took a lot of rehearsal and a lot of kind of finding the right people, because we changed drummers quite a few times. In fact, the guy who was originally the drummer in the band is a guy called Mark King, who's now known as the bass player in Level 42. But we changed drummers quite a few times before we eventually I worked with Roly. But I'd already played with Roly in a previous band, and we were good friends. So that's really kind of how it came about. And then everybody used to kind of come to London. Mark lived on the Isle of Wight. Francois lived in Brighton. And then when we rehearsed, they'd descend on London and end up sleeping on my floor. And then we'd spend the entire weekend rehearsing. We were intense as far as rehearsals go. We'd do long stints. You know, I hear about some bands who go, oh, yeah, we had a rehearsal and it was like sort of 3 or 4 hours. We'd do at least 8 or more hours a day, and we'd do it over Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then try and recover. But it produced a lot of songs and a lot of kind of really interesting arrangements. It was cool, yeah.
So who came up with the band name Reflex? Does it have a meaning behind it, or is it just something you guys came up with being creative?
There is a story behind it. Originally, I'm not sure if you're aware, but we have a box set which is called Refuse, and there's a reason behind it, and there's an explanation, which is that originally Refuse was the name of the band. That came about because I was really taken with a graffiti campaign that happened around that time, that was in London, which always signed every statement Refuse. And one of the best ones, which I used actually for the album, was written on the side of the Hampstead Theatre Club, which just said, "The stage of history, the only one worth playing, Refuse." It just struck a note with me, but we had a long discussion about it. You know, the people going, oh, you know, in America it sounds like refuse, and do you want anybody to say that you're rubbish? But years late, not like that long after, because somebody, you know, Butch Vig named his band Garbage. I always liked the fact that there was ambiguity to the name. You know, and that's, we kept that with Reflex. There was this event when I took everybody to see this graffiti, and we drove across London to see it. And then there was this kind of, is that what we're called then? And we had this long debate about it. But yeah, that's the history of the name.
That's really good. That's a nice little story. I like that. The Politics of Dancing is probably what the Reflex is, or what Reflex is best known for. Did you guys know it was going to be an obvious hit back when you were making that song, recording the song?
I thought other songs were more commercial and possibly even more likely to be hits. You know, songs like, they were also released as singles. Hitline. Praying to the Beat. And also Something About You. Every song on that album was clocked as being a possible single. But when it came to Politics, it was John Punter, who was our producer, who really felt that was such a strong record. And to tell you the truth, you know, the company EMI in the UK, they didn't release Politics, first of all. They released the other tracks that were all kind of sort of minor hits. Yeah. They all went into the top 40 or whatever, or just around there or something like that. But it was only when Politics was released in America, which is where it was released first of all, that it became a hit. And everybody else around the world started to go, whoa, we should look at this band.
You kind of alluded to it just a little bit ago, but you've been busy since, I think, 2010, kind of re-releasing a lot of the Reflex's unreleased material, solo album or other albums.
We put together a box set about just over 10 years ago, and it was because Rowley, who was still alive at the time, and I wanted to do this, and we wanted to put together this kind of crazy website that we originally created in Flash and you can't use anymore. But we were just experimenting, and the two of us worked together anyway. So it was like, sort of, oh, mate. The other thing was that what had happened was, because quite a lot of our material hadn't been officially released and EMI didn't have the permission to release it, there was starting to be quite a lot of bootlegs of things. And we thought, well, let's try and, if we're going to put it out there, let's make sure it's the stuff that we want. Therefore, it's come from the right masters or whatever, as opposed to somebody's, poor cassette. It's kind of started then, really. And then, unfortunately, Rowley became very ill and then consequently died. And that seriously messed us up.
Well, we were recently recommended the latest album, Vibrate Generate, which features some great new songs, unreleased songs, and remixes. Were there any tracks in particular that you were glad to see released as part of this album or this compilation?
I don't know if you've seen the sleeve notes, but maybe I should send them to you. It kind of explains a lot about what happened. And we recorded the title track just before Rowley died because we wanted to do this one last this project together. When we recorded, he thought he was going to, we all believed he was getting better. And it was meant to be our kind of motivation for him. Then after we knew the track was very special, but after he died, I couldn't bring myself to listen to it for about, I don't know, almost 10 years. Yeah. I couldn't just listen to it at all, even though I knew it was still really good and we should put it out there. And then what happened was, about 2 years ago, I was contacted by a company called Cherry Red, who put together a special edition of The Politics of Dancing, which included all of the EMI recorded material. So that was not just The Politics of Dancing, but also the 12 inches, the B-sides that we'd recorded. So there were quite a lot of other tracks. And that sold pretty well and still does sell fairly well. But what happened was they came back to me and said, is there anything else? And I said, well, there's this track. And I said, but I don't want to just release one track. And I know other people have talked to me about doing remixes. If you can get me the multi-track of everything that I want, then I'll look at remixing it, which is what I did. And just creating, it's not meant to be, oh, this is going to be so different. It's just, it is a different interpretation, possibly a more updated interpretation in the way it's mixed. But I don't believe in radically changing tracks, you know, where the only thing that you remember from the original is the title. It's just not my idea of what that remixing should be about. Also, there was another track. We included another new track, which was a song called Human, which Bats had written. And so we added those in with all, there's loads of remixes on it. One of the reasons I did it is it's sort of like a compilation of the best of Reflex, I suppose. But even then, there's loads of other stuff that wasn't included that's still really great. It was just something that came up because Cherry Red had asked me, do you want to do something else? And I felt it was time to release Vibrate Generate, just because so many people over the years had heard about that we'd got together to record this and were intending to put it out. But then because of Roly, I just couldn't do it at the time. You know?
Yeah, completely understand that. But it is a great, it's a great track. I also really like what you guys did for the video, where it's got yourself, Baxter, Craig, all from the early lineup, and then you had James, the son of the drummer, fill in. And I thought that was a great tribute and a great way to kind of cross connect multi generations for that video.
I'm glad you appreciated it. I mean, you know, the video also features another good. There's the kid who's in the the young boy's in the, who's mimes the first verse, and that's Louis Starkey. And he's Ringo's grandson.
That is interesting.
Yeah, it's a nice little connection there. And it was great that James did it. James is Roly's son, and he did it as playing the drums for it. And also Francois. You know, I'm still in touch with Francois, so I asked him. You know, it was a very it was difficult to do because we did it during around the time of lockdown. Everybody had to be recorded separately. It took a while to make that video. And then it takes a while to make most of the videos that I do, but I've done quite a few of them in recent years. There were lots of reasons why we wanted to release Vibrate Generate. It was nice to have the support of the people, you know, involved. And also because there were, I'm still in contact with some of the people that were involved at the time and knew about us or knew about what had been happening to since.
So is there any other Reflex albums or reissues on the horizon, or you think you've kind of exhausted all the Reflex catalog?
There's a possibility of, I've looked at restoring some live video. It's one of the things that, such a great shame that despite the amount of gigs, we've got very little real live stuff. We've got lots of television stuff, and that's different. You know, I mean, an actual performance. So we've got one gig, which was reasonably well recorded, and I might look at that. But most of my attention has been spent in recent years just dealing with my solo career. About 2019, I released an album called It's About Time, which was an instrumental electronic album, well, two of them, it's part one and part two. And then I started to release some other stuff, such as the Boom Boom album, which features the track two, Into the Groove. I don't know if you've seen that video. I released that album, which was something I'd recorded with a guy called Dave Harris. And that was something that had been in the kind of we kept on saying for years, oh, we must release this one day. It's just full of lots of good songs. About a year ago, I released an album called Artificial Intelligence, which is really my first solo album where I'm doing lots of singing. And in about June the 16th, I'm releasing my next album, which is called Abnormal. So I recently put out, a few weeks ago, I put out a single called Dysfunctional. I don't know if you've heard that. Or seen
that. I have. That was actually one of my questions. You have a new single, Dysfunctional. And will there be a new album? And it sounds like there is one coming out in the next couple months.
Yeah. Well, what's happening, I just agreed this yesterday. The next single from the album is called Poverty. It's my comment about in the world of why we have poverty still. When I was a kid, I thought all this kind of nonsense would be solved. We're not going to have this in our generation, but we still do. You know, and it goes on. So, there's the single Poverty. And then there's also, then shortly after that, about 2 weeks later, the album will come out. And that's called Abnormal.
I'm really looking forward to that. But if we can back up just a little bit, I've got a couple of questions on your solo stuff. With your 2019 album, It's About Time, as you mentioned, it's parts one and two. And I really like the tracks and encourage our listeners to check out Born to Synthesize. And Over and Out. I really like those ones as well as the rest of the album. What was the thought to release of the two separate albums?
What happened was that I stopped for quite a while. I was producing other people or doing just a lot of film-related music, because I produce quite a lot of film music. And I'd stopped really thinking about writing stuff specifically for myself. Before I made It's About Time, I produced two classical albums of solo violin music, or just accompaniment of a piano. That kind of got me back into thinking more about writing sort of some serious pieces of music and experimenting a lot more. I felt it was easier to do for me at the time to do instrumentally. And I wanted to kind of go back to something that I'd looked at. I did an album quite a few years back, which is going to get re-released at some point, called, it came out under the name Limited Noise. And the album was called It's About 8 Minutes. I did it with a guy from Frankie Goes to Hollywood called Peter Gill. The kind of work that we were doing then, and which relates to It's About Time, was to see if you can push the barrier of what's possible to do with music or electronic music, and also to try and make music, electronic music, that had emotion to it. It wasn't just about being robotic or mechanical, but actually had kind of emotion to it. So that's where that album kind of started to come together. And then I started to do things like, if you listen to a lot of the guitars, nearly all the guitars on that album are played by my son Todd, who's also a very gifted musician. And that was kind of nice for us to do something like that together. But he's now played on Artificial Intelligence and also on this album.
And speaking of Artificial Intelligence, that album clearly written on some of those songs during the events of 2020. What can you tell our listeners about that particular album?
So let me think. I'd started to write songs, and one of the things that really kicked me off was I'd written the song about Trump, Bad Man. That's what you are. Say, he's a racist, I'm another with a bad attitude. having gone through the thing of watching the news every night, and I'm not just going to say this is just about Trump, because I also felt this about Boris Johnson, right? But when you see people behaving in a way and you go, that's possibly not the way that you would expect a politician or somebody who deals with international relations to behave, I felt that it was necessary to say something, as I did about art should reflect its time. Writers should write about the world they live in. So that's about my feelings towards that. But then also I wrote things like lockdown. We got lockdown, lockdown, lockdown. Which was to do with the whole experience of COVID and living in a world that suddenly changed overnight and to something that was beyond anybody's concept of what life was. I still feel strongly about things in my life. You know, I still feel I have a beliefs and an opinion, and you feel as an artist that you want to express that. And I've never really been the sort of person who just writes lovey-dovey songs and, you know, I've never been looking for a hit as such. All I want to do is create music that has some honesty to it. A lot of the songs on that album reflect the time, as do the ones that are on this album. They reflect what's going on in my life. I mean, you know, the song on Artificial Intelligence, I'm just trying to remember all the songs now. There's the song 40 Years. 40 years is a long time to wait. Could live forever, but it's never too late. 40 years of hanging around. I wanna see her face. 40 years. Which is about a relationship that I had, or about that I'm still involved in. That happened 40 years after I first met the girl. You know, we used to be boyfriend and girlfriend in our early 20s. And then this girl went back to France to live, had her life, and so did I. And then she got in contact with me after she read something about It's About Time. And we started a relationship. It's about the fact to find yourself having a relationship with somebody 40 years after having never seen them or been in contact during that time. It was very bizarre, and still is, particularly since we had it right. It's an international relationship right in the middle of COVID. So I always kind of write about what's going on in my life. You know, writing music is a form of therapy, I suppose, or at least you've got to get it out off your chest. On the new album, I've written songs about Putin, Boris Johnson, and quite a few other topics as well. It's a more philosophical view about life, but I'm always looking for something different. I can't stand doing the same thing again and again. Even if you're good at it, it's a tedious experience. You can't imagine, oh, yeah. Do you know, I'll think if I was a painter, oh, Mona Lisa too. They don't work like that, but in music, people do that kind of thing. Or I'll make it very much like the last one, just so that all the fans will like it. If you don't take risks, then it's boring. Yep. And those risks are an essential ingredient to what makes music interesting and so special. Yep. You go, well, I'm still getting buzzed off music. I still get the thrill when I write something new or come up with a new idea. You go, oh, isn't it great that you can make something just, you go, well, actually, that kind of makes me happy. So I have a friend of mine who's quite a well-known artist. His name is Bob. He puts his work out. You can look him up. He's called Bob and Roberta Smith. Yeah, two names. And you'll find him. He's in famous galleries. You can find him in the Tate, in the Royal Academy. Anyway, we were having a chat one day. He said to me, we were talking about kind of art and music and stuff, and just the process of making it. And he said to me, you know, Paul, says, I don't know about this kind of, I'm not really sure about all this art therapy lark. They use kind of making art as counseling or whatever it is. But he said, I'm not really sure about this art therapy, Lark. But he said, I've noticed something. I said, what's that, Bob? So he goes, well, whenever I make something, it makes me happy. And I thought, wait a moment. I think that's it, isn't it? Isn't that the key thing? It's not because somebody else goes, oh, that's great. It's because you made it and it makes you happy, the fact that you actually made it. Whether somebody else likes it is another thing, yeah? But it depends on your motivations for making music. If you're making it just to be famous, then that's different, isn't it? Or you'll do anything. Then you become sort of a prostitute almost because you have no real identity.
Well, listening to your album, Artificial Intelligence, especially the first two tracks, I really liked how they kind of had that George Clinton vibe, kind of maybe out of 1982's computer games. Didn't know if that was a conscious decision or if it just turned out that way, but it was very enjoyable.
Yeah. I got into this idea a while ago which relates to P-Funk, right? And I thought, I've got to use P for Paul. Yeah. But I love material like that. I love, and, you know, you can clearly hear that I love Prince. I love Sly and the Family Stone. And I still have those things in my music. I often think to myself, oh, maybe I should grow up, stop doing stuff like that. And you go, actually, but I still like it. So if it's good, why not? And I like experimenting with different ways to make music. I try not to use the same process. Otherwise, you end up in the same place. And I don't like that. A bit like if you were an artist and you go, I only use these colors. I only use these materials and this type of canvas. You're going to end up with a similar picture, aren't you? It's always good to have fresh ingredients or sometimes other musicians. You know, I'm very fortunate. You may have noticed there's quite an astonishing sax solo on Dysfunctional. And there's also a pretty damn good one, which is on the single On. Which is off Artificial Intelligence, which weirdly enough, that video also features another member of the Starkey family. The drummer in it is also... is in fact Louis' younger brother. They keep on turning up in my videos. But both those songs feature Leo Richardson, who's just this godsend of a saxophonist that I met a few years ago. I said to somebody recently, I think he's from another planet. It's just super cool. So it's nice having different colors to work with and a different approach.
I'm really looking forward to the new album. Big fan of Artificial Intelligence. So, Paul, how's the best way for our listeners to keep up to date when the new album comes out, the new singles? How's the best way to follow you?
Probably on either there's a Facebook Paul Fishman Music page, the website Paul Fishman Music. There's Instagram, you know, all of that stuff. Or you can just listen to my stuff on Spotify, iTunes, you know, all the digital companies, I think. Well, most of them have now got my recent work. So that's probably the best way.
Yeah, I'll definitely also make sure to put all the links for all your social medias in our show description so our listeners can check it out. I would highly recommend it.
I'm very happy that I still get a thrill out of making music. And I'm very happy that I'm still able to discover new things that I want to do. So that's kind of makes it worthwhile doing them, really. And even though I'm not in a position where I'm going out, oh, yeah, I'm going to promote this album. I'm doing loads of, you know, people write to me, are you going to be doing any gigs? And I think, oh, my God, no. The best, only thing I might consider is doing something within my studio at some point, you know, like a live feed or something like that. But I can't foresee myself going out and playing lots of concerts. I still got offers every year for, well, would Reflex like to come on this 80s tour? And I think, oh, God, no. It's also, I don't like going backwards. I would hate to be somebody who just lived on that time in the 80s. just like I read something recently, because I don't know if you've seen in my bio, but I did an album with Public Image after Reflex, and I saw, because John Lydon's been in the press recently because unfortunately his wife died, and John was talking about the fact that people always go, oh, John, talk to us about the Sex Pistols, right? And he goes, no, I don't really want to do that. That was a tiny part of my life. And really what I'm interested in is what he's done since. And I totally understand that, particularly because when you get older, you maybe reevaluate some of the things that you did when you were younger. Doesn't mean that, you know, you would necessarily regret them, but you might see it from a different perspective.
Well, Paul, I can't thank you enough for spending some time with us today on the podcast. I've learned a lot. I'm sure our listeners have as well. And we're really looking forward to the new album.
Thank you very much. And a big hi to your listeners. All right.
We hope you guys enjoyed that interview. And remember, you can always follow us on pretty much any social media platform of choice. Just look for New Wave Music Podcast. And we hope to see you guys on our next episode.